Amen. Father, we just ask you today that you would come in your own special way, Lord. Lord, we're your people here, and we want to know you more. We want to just be able to serve you in a greater capacity. Lord, we want to have our ears open. We want our eyes open. We want our understanding to be enlightened, my God, that we can capture the length and the breadth and the depth and the height and everything that you are, my God, that we can embrace who you are and what you are, and not what our pea-minded brain tells us. Release us from natural thinking into supernatural thinking. Release us from our us to you, my God. Because, Lord, you do want to lift us up on those thermals. You want to take us to a place. Oh, I think there's a word there. God wants to take us to a place. I'm reminded of Paul before, when he was Saul. He thought he was doing God's will, but God wanted to take him to a place where he could meet with his God. How many people here really want to meet with your God? Come on, lift up your hands. Lord, take us to a place. Take us to a Jesus, take us to a place in you, which is exceedingly abundantly above, more than we can ever think. That we're reminded that your ways are higher than our ways, your ways are greater than our ways. And the great I am would come and help us and lift us up. And I just sense that God wants, as an eagle would catch the thermals that would take it to a higher place, my God, that we would catch the thermals of your Spirit that would cause us to rise above our natural ability, Lord, into a supernatural ability. Oh, Jesus, that we realize that we're carriers of the manifestation of God. We're not nobodies, we're somebodies. We're a people that are going to a place in you. I pray for every one of us to go to a special place in our God. Amen. A special place. Amen. I was coming in this morning, just driving in my car, and all of a sudden, I felt the presence of God just fill my car. It's a good thing. Amen? It's a good thing. It's a good thing. It's just minding my own business. Driving the car. And it's like you go to a place where all of a sudden God's all around you. I believe God wants us to live in that place. Amen? I want to just piggyback off last week a little bit if I can. Genesis 1:26, God said, "Let us make man in our, capital O, image, according to our, capital O, likeness." In other words, when God created man, he created him as a supernatural being. He created him with dominion and authority and power and everything that could see God and walk with God and talk with God and embrace God. That's how God created people in his own image. God is not a man. God is a supernatural person. Amen. God made man in his own image and in his own likeness. In Genesis 2:7, God created man, and it says that he created him and then he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living being. We've been singing a lot this morning about this breath. Breathe on us and this breath. I believe that God wants to breathe into us again the breath of life. Jesus walked up to his disciples and he spoke to them and he breathed on them. He said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Then he breathed on them. Friend, I want to tell you what we've been singing about, what we've been talking about this morning, is very, very real in the heart of God. But God wants to breathe something special into us today and every day. He wants to come in his own special way. So God created man, and he breathed the breath of life into his nostrils, and he became a living being. And then the fall came, and then the results. We know that man was separated. Man was driven out. Man was put out into another place. In Genesis 5:3, it says, "And Adam lived 130 years and begot a son in his own likeness, small o." Fallen, separated, rejected, after his small h image, and called him Seth. So after the fall, people were created in the image of Adam, fallen. That's why Jesus says, "Marvel not that I say to you, you must be born again." For a period of time, man's sin was covered by the blood of bulls and goats. God had a provision for people. But all these people that had died before Jesus came all lived in hope, hoping that one day that the Messiah would come and deliver them and pay the price in full. In reality, the blood of bulls and goats was like the down payment or the deposit that Jesus paid for. Well, amen. And so we find here that man is in a fallen state and we need to get born again. We need to get born again. But when we get born again, lots of things start to happen. Amen. After Adam and Eve came together, they had their Seth. We find there that the drive for acceptance was on, drive for success, drive to be accepted. And what really started to happen was there came a war between the ways of man or flesh and the ways of God's spirit. But the new birth does so much for us. And I think if we can really understand this new birth, it's not just a ticket to heaven. It's not just a feeling, or it's not just joining a church. Some people, you know, they may have gone to church because their mother went to church or because somebody else went to church. And they've never had that encounter. They've never had that being born again. They've never really had that experience of being transformed, being changed. I don't know about you, but I remember very, very clearly getting born again. I remember that there was this flesh man, there was this outward man, but there was also now an inward man. There was something that happened to Neil the day he got born again. I did not understand it. I could not comprehend it. All I knew was something happened. All I knew that I had changed. And when I went back to work on the Monday, some of the people that I work with said, "What happened to you?" And really, I was ashamed or embarrassed. I didn't want to tell them that I went to church because I was a macho man. I didn't want to talk because I didn't even want to go to church. I only went to church because Nancy wanted me to go to church. And now I experienced something that I cannot understand. But people saw that there was a change in my life. And friend, I want to tell you, God will bring great change to your life. God is in the changing business. He will change a drunk into a worshiper of God. Amen. He will change a drug addict into somebody there that can be totally transformed and become a demon destroyer. I look at Corrie back there as she was involved in I don't know what, witchcraft, goodness knows what. But the Spirit of God touched her. She has lived her life since then. She was going to Malaysia every year. She was ministering and touching people. She has literally touched thousands of lives because God wants to change our failures into success in Jesus' name. Amen. We can baste ourselves in the hurts and the negativities and carry on if we want to, or else we can rise up, grow up, and get out and become what God wants us to become. When Jesus Christ came on the scene, he walked on this planet, he said, "I only do the things that I see my Father do." He spoke to a group of people there that were fishermen and tax collectors and different people, but he gathered them together and he did something so dynamic. He breathed the breath of life into them and they became something so dynamic and so powerful that they touched the then known world. Because of those 12 people and because of the 120 that got filled with the Holy Spirit after that, today, in this year that we live in, we still worship the Christ. Because they established something that could never, ever be blotted out by any devil. Amen. The Word of God will be preached on this planet until Jesus comes back. It's going to be preached with power and with authority, with compassion, with everything that God can put into it. Amen. But you see, the war came, and there's a war between the flesh and the spirit. The war between what the enemy wants to sow into your life and what God wants to sow into your life. God says, I've taken you out of the kingdom of darkness and I've translated you into the kingdom of my dear Son. Friend, I do not want to stay halfway. I do not want to try to walk this tightrope in one and out the other. I want to walk strong. I want to walk fully committed to the Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. I am no longer a slave to sin. I am no longer, I can make choices though. One of the sad things that we've still got a choice. God doesn't want a bunch of robots that'll just be like little puppy dogs doing whatever he wants them to do. He wants us to fall in love with him, and out of passion and compassion and a love for our God, we want to serve him passionately. Amen. We want to do the right thing. Amen. We want to do what is right. That's what we want to do. So the enemy comes on the scene again as Jesus raises up his church, as he comes and pays a price and he gives his life. He hangs upon a cross. But you see, the devil stirs up the religious, stirs up people, and gets them thinking wrong. Friend, wrong thinking has destroyed much of the church. We've got to think right. So the enemy comes in to destroy. Why did the religious leaders, the people that most surely prayed every day for the Messiah to appear, the people there that were longing for the coming of the Messiah, why all of a sudden, when the Messiah comes, when he pays the price, when he goes to the grave, when he's been raised up again, that they allow the enemy to get inside them and stir them up so much that they, when the disciples came and started preaching that Jesus is alive, he's risen from the dead, it made them so angry. Anger filled them and wrath filled them. They most probably thought, we've got rid of Jesus and now we've got 120 of them. Why did they get so angry when the disciples came and the religious leaders got so angry and react so badly when the disciples preached Jesus risen from the dead, the Messiah, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords? Hallelujah. Friend, we don't serve some pipsqueak God. We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. The Messiah. Oh, Sharabundi. You know what? Why the devil got so angry? Because Jesus, at that last words he spoke, he said, "It is finished." You know what? Some of us need to hear that word over our lives, that we realize that there are certain things that keep harassing you, that Jesus said, "It is finished." You can hang on to it if you want to, but as far as God's concerned, it is finished. Friend, I'm speaking ultimate. Are we there yet? No, but we're getting there. Hallelujah. Amen. Have we achieved it? No, but the truth is the truth, and the truth must be preached. I don't want to preach compromise to you. I don't want to put a band-aid on the problem. I want to destroy the problem. Because that's what Jesus came to do, to destroy the works of Satan. You believe that? Do you believe he did it? I believe he did it. They got so angry because this meant Satan's grip on humanity was finished. When Jesus rose from the dead, Satan's grip on humanity was finished. That's worth a yes. Think of it. Satan's grip on humanity was finished. Done. Over. Complete. Kaput. No more. The enemy goes around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. If he can sow deceit, discord, whatever it might be, lies, he will steal from you, because that is what the enemy does. The enemy's purpose on this planet is to come to rob, to destroy, and to kill. But Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundant. Hallelujah. More abundant life. Amen. That's what Jesus has come to do. The enemy also comes like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. If he can sow a lie into your thinking, you will stay destroyed. You will say, work out yourself. It meant Satan's grip on humanity was finished, ended. The price of our redemption was paid in full. You got to see that. Paid in full over us, amen? Paid in full. And Satan stirred up the religious people to try to stop the truth from getting out. But I want to say today, praise God, the word is out. Hallelujah. We're going to preach it from the hilltops. We're going to preach it from the chairs. We're going to preach it in the court. We're going to preach it. Hallelujah. The word is out. Jesus is alive. Yeah. Devil tried to do whatever he could to stop him. He stirred the religious people up. He stirred them up. He did this, he did that. But I want to tell you today that our Christ rose from the dead and the word is out. Amen. It's alive. The word of God's alive. I love the word. How many people love the word of God? He's alive. He's risen from the dead. Our God is alive. Whoops. Sorry. Satan set up the religious leaders to put a great stone and seal the tomb and place guards around the tomb. Can you imagine this? The devil gets inside of him and causes him to do things there that they don't even know what they're doing. But he stirred up the religious leaders to put a great stone away because they said, we've got this man now. We've got rid of him. Hallelujah. We've crucified him. That's the end of it. But we've got to be careful because on the third day, he said he was going to rise again. I want to tell you, every devil in hell heard that too. They said the third day that he's going to rise again. I want to tell you, put fear in the heart of the enemy and every demon in hell. But I want to tell you, there's something else that puts fear in the heart of the enemy. And it says, I'm going to build my church and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. Hallelujah. I'm going to build a people, hallelujah, that are going to be carriers of my word. And they're going to go forth with power and with authority. And they're going to slap you up the side of the head, devil. And they're going to command you in Jesus' name to get out and you're going to go. We're going to learn authority, hallelujah. We're going to learn that we can say to this devil, go, and he'll go. We're going to speak to that sickness and say, go, and it'll go. We're going to be able to speak to that thing and say, go. But friend, I want to tell you, God is raising up an army. We are in boot camp, hallelujah. God is training us, amen. How many else, anybody else in boot camp? Glory to God. Hell, I want to tell you, the enemy there, he starts stirring up people. He starts stirring up these religious people. Can you imagine them? They say, hey, put that great stone, seal the tomb, and place guards around the tomb because he said he was going to rise up. I want to tell you, this dead man, Jesus, terrified Satan. I like that. Send him to the dispensary, pulling out Panadol and Agarol and any other roll. I want to tell you, friends, I want to be part of the end time church, yeah, that terrifies Satan. Amen. Yeah. I want to be part of the church that terrifies Satan. Hallelujah. And every devil in hell say, oh no, there's a bunch of people down there. They're a motley bunch. But I want to tell you, they're starting to break through. There's a crack in the armor. There's a crack in the wall. Something's starting to happen. The wind of God's starting to blow on them. There's something happening. There's a rising up. Oh, Jesus, I don't want to go to America. I want to stay here. Oh, Satan was terrified of this dead man. How much terrified would he be of a living church? Jesus said, I will rise again on the third day. The resurrection of Jesus is proof of Satan's defeat. It's a proof of man's redemption. I am redeemed. Hallelujah. Can you turn to somebody and say, you're redeemed today? I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm a new creature. Hallelujah. I'm a brand new man. Oh, hallelujah. All things are passed away. All things become new. I've been filled with the Holy Ghost power. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Victory is ours. Oh, shakabundi. Oh, Jesus is alive. How many people know Jesus alive? Are you alive? Jesus is alive. Paid the price in full, praise God. I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. The resurrection of Jesus gave God legal right to make the believer a new creation. Legal right. I believe it's very, very important for us to know that the devil has got no words, nothing, because Jesus stripped him of everything. Amen? God had legal right because of his son's death, because of his son's resurrection, to raise up an army, to raise up a people of believers that know who they are. Make a believer a new creature. I don't know about you, but I needed to be made new. Amen? Anybody else here? In Jesus, we have. Everybody say, we have. Redemption. Through his blood. We have forgiveness of sin. According to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound. I want you to hear this word, abound. Abundance of grace. Not a little squeaky bit, not just a little tingy bit. He's not mean God. He is an abundant God, amen. I needed abundance of grace. He made his grace abound towards us. Isn't that amazing? That God, while we were even yet sinners, he caused his grace to come upon us. By grace I was saved, hallelujah. I wasn't looking for God, but praise God, God was looking for me. I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been washed with the blood, hallelujah. I am not ashamed of this gospel. It is the power of God unto salvation. This gospel must be preached. The word has to get out. The word is out, hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. I don't know about you, but I'm getting a bit excited here. According to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound. This is Ephesians 1, 7 and 8. Towards us in all wisdom and understanding. Satan has tried to blind the eyes of believers through religion, wrong teaching, and fear. I want to tell you, God prays. He breathes life Lies and deceit and wrong teaching brings death. Too many people in the church are dead. We have our redemption. I have redemption. Amen. I am redeemed. It's not just something we have to wait for, pray for, or ask for. The moment we were born again, saved, received Jesus into our life, however you did it, at that moment, redemption is ours. Hallelujah. I don't care who you were, what you did in the past, when you came and honestly stood before God and said, Jesus, will you come into my life? Will you forgive me? And you really sincerely got born again. Friend, I want to tell you today, there's too many people get a sign of form so they can get a free cappuccino. No, I'm talking about people getting born again. Yeah. I'm talking about sincerely, honestly coming before God and saying, God, I need a Savior. I need to be washed in the blood. I am a sinner. I need you, Lord. I need you. I need you. I need you. When you honestly come there, and whether you got all the warts, you could have your drugs in your pocket, you could have mess around your life, but you walk up there that moment, you are redeemed. Hallelujah. You might go home and kick the dog. You don't have to, but I'm just saying you might. You might go home and kick the devil. You like that one better. What I'm saying is you still carry some of the old lifestyle, old things, but I'm born again. I mean, I'm redeemed. I'm on my way to heaven. I'm saved, washed in the precious blood. That moment is ours. Satan's dominion over us ends. See, if we don't understand that, if we don't really understand Satan's dominion over us ends, that we are free, we now rule and reign with Christ, if we don't understand that, we will still think that we are under Satan's domain. And you live in fear, you live under that thing. But friend, we're free, amen? I don't know about you, but I don't know whether this is even a word. But I'm going to try it anyhow. If I play Scrabble, I can beat you every time because I can make a word out of anything I've got in front of me. I was metamorphosized. Is that a word? Praise God, I thought I just created a new word. I was a grub. I was. So were some of you. I knew some of you. But I changed. I got born again. And like getting born again is like going into that chrysalis. And I came out a hallelujah butterfly. Amen. Changed from crawling on the face of the earth to flying and catching the thermals in Jesus' name. Amen. What is it? I can't even remember it now. It's gone. Satan's dominion over us ended. Turn to somebody and say, the minute I got born again, Satan's dominion over me ended. I'm free. I'm free. I'm free. I said that one day, I'm free. And a little girl there, she looked at her mother and she said, he's only free, I'm four. I kept saying it. It must have got into her. Christ died in my place. Can you even spell it? I want you to put that up every Sunday so they remember me and they won't forget that I used to be here. You'll forget me in 4 weeks. Christ died in my place. He went down into Hades to lift us up above, to lift me out of the miry clay, to put my feet upon a rock to stay. Hallelujah. He went down to lift me up. He went down to take me out. He went down and died so I might live. That's it. That's what happened. Amen. He wasn't on a picnic. He went down there with purpose. He had me on his mind. Shakabundi, amen. Ephesians 2:6 says this, and raised us up together and made us sit together. Where are you sitting today? You're sitting on the devil's lap trying to praise God. You're sitting where the enemy's got you bound up and where are you? It says, and raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Where are you sitting? Where are we all sitting today? He raised me up, hallelujah. Took me out of the miry clay, put my feet upon that rock. He took me into heavenly places. I'm seated with Christ, hallelujah, far above principalities and powers and dominion and every hairy-legged whoop-whoop devil that would try to come my way. We are above, not beneath. I've heard it said before, stop acting like turkeys when God wants you to act like an eagle. We are crucified with him, died with him, were buried with him, suffered with him, were justified by him, were made alive with him, conquered Satan with him, and were raised together with him. That's who we are. Lord, lift us up where we belong. Take us to that place. I believe God wants to take us to a place. The resurrection of Jesus is proof of our victory over our enemy, Satan. You know, in the Olympics there, the Australians call English our old enemy. And they're still fighting that battle, but they're our mates. The resurrection of Jesus is proof of our victory over our enemy, Satan. Amen. It is proof that cannot be denied. Every person who received Jesus as Lord and Savior in the mind of God is a victor over Satan. You need to hear this. Every person who is born again in the mind of God is victor over Satan and his works. And you know what? I believe too that Satan is saying, why don't they rise up? Because you know what? He knows it too. In God's mind, every one of us are victors over Satan's domain. We've just got to rise up. We've got to start demonstrating. We've got to start speaking it. We've got to start doing things a little bit different. You know, it's not easy to accept the truth, especially if you're being beat up. Anybody here ever been beat up? Come on, raise your hand, tell the truth, shame the devil. Come on, but the Bible doesn't say, you're going to go to kindergarten when you get saved. No, he says, the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. He also says these light afflictions. Ooh, I hate that verse. But I don't hate it. Please, sorry. These light afflictions which we're going through are working for us. You know why? Because when the enemy comes in, if we can stand up and say, I'm not going to cop this anymore. Instead of allowing the enemy to triumph over it. It's not easy except when you're going through it, being beat up, going through some difficult times. People say, don't tell me that. Don't tell me that I've got victory over Satan. Don't tell me that. Tell me it's the devil's fault. You know, people in flesh want to blame somebody else. When Jesus broke the curse of death, having conquered death, Satan and sin, he conquered death, Satan and sin. It was our victory. So what I've got to do is I've got to pick myself up by this pants and take myself over here and put me where God wants me to be. You'll remember that. You'll remember that. If I just said it, you wouldn't remember it. I'll do it again. You got to pick yourself up and don't allow the enemy to get you seated on his lap. You got to get yourself up and say, I'm going over here where I've been raised up with Christ. I'm seated with him, hallelujah. And devil, for you to get to me, you got to get through him. And I want to tell you, devil, I want to remind you, he whipped you good. You're as gummy as a badger. He took your teeth out. He stripped you of your authority. He stripped you of all power. He took it all off you, and you are got nothing left. See, that's the truth. Say, but the devil that comes after me is me. He's a monster. The Bible says that in the last days, the devil's going to be displayed. He's going to be let out. He's a little spitzweak. Is that right? What does it say? I'm just going here. I don't know where I'm going. But he's going to be let out. Is he little? It doesn't say that. I'm going to say that anyhow. For the sake of the preach. And people can say, that's not the devil that chased me. Mine was a big one. No, it's a little one. Defeated one. On his belly, eating dust all the days of his life. On his belly, that's it. We got the scripture. On his belly, eating dust. That's the one that's chasing you. Eating dust on his belly. Cursed. He wants you to think you're cursed. I'm not cursed. I am not cursed. I am blessed. Hallelujah. I am the blessed. Hallelujah. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I don't know about the rest, but I'm blessed. The victory, our victory was in the victory of Jesus Christ. Colossians 3:1. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Matthew 6:33 says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Church, can I please, I want to encourage us to go after God, to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, hallelujah, that God can have his way with us. God can do whatever he wants to do with us. I'm nearly finished. God has lifted the believer above all rule and authority and power and dominion. You believe that today? God has lifted the believer. Give me a wave if you're a believer. Come on, a big wave, a big, big wave. God has lifted the believer above all rule and authority and power and dominion, not only in this age, but in that which is to come. He has put all things in subjection under the believer's feet. God has lifted the believer above all. Everybody say all. That's that word that Kendall was using this morning. All rule and authority and power and dominion, not only in this age, but in that which is to come. And he put all things in subjection under the believer's feet. I want to tell you, friends, we're going to have to believe, start pushing through some stuff and start telling the devil and understanding who he is and know who we are and say without anything going on in your mind thinking, oh, what's the devil going to do? No, he has to obey because God has given you all dominion, all authority, all power over the devil, and nothing that the devil can do will harm you. Most people that I talk to are fearful of the devil. The devil should be fearful of us. I heard John Osteen talking one day about demons who were going up and down the street. And they came into his house and tried to annoy him or something. Anyhow, he got up out of bed and he told them their pedigree and told them where to go and how to get out. And they ran with their tail between their legs down the street. They said next time they came to the street, all the demons got to the end of the corners like those other people with the little bags and said, don't go to 36. Don't go to that house. I want the devil saying that about my house. Don't go to this house. Don't go to that house. Amen. We are not going to tolerate stuff because I believe we've got power and authority to cast it out. Amen. He gave Christ, who is the head of the body, to be master over all the forces of the universe. Is that who we serve, or isn't that who we serve? Jesus gave the believer the legal right to use his name. He actually gave us the power of attorney. So that in the name of Jesus, every demon power should obey when a believer speaks that name. Amen. Church, as I close, be bold. Dare to believe God's word. Rise up and speak the word of God with confidence and boldness. I'm a new creation, amen. I'm a new creature. I'm coming out from under the lies of Satan. I'm coming into the presence of God. I'm filled with His Spirit. That means I'm filled with God's power. That's who I am. I'm healed. I'm free because I'm raised with Christ and I'm far above all that rubbish in Jesus' name. Amen. Christ the King. I'm not trying to say that we will never have a battle. All I know is the battle's not mine. The battle's not mine. And you know what? The centurion, Jesus came to the centurion, and the centurion said, my servant's sick, blah, blah, blah. And Jesus said, I'll come to your house. And he said, no, you don't have to come to my house. Just speak the word only. And Jesus marveled because he had not seen that authority expressed in all of Israel. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we, the church, I'm just talking about we, us, church, it's thousands of us, okay, would rise up and start speaking what Jesus says about us. Start speaking the word of God. Start telling the devil his pedigree. Start rebuking him, amen. Telling him to get lost instead of accommodating him. That Jesus in heaven would look down and say, man, I haven't seen such great faith before, amen. Because there's an army that's beginning to rise. There's an army that's beginning to rise. You're going to be part of that army? If you're going to be part of that army, just stand to your feet right now. Stand to our feet in Jesus' name.